Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I've taken the liberty of coming back here once again, running all the way back off screen, so you guys will have to deal with that. But anyway, persuasion. I want to see if we can ask Liliana on a date, even though we get a negative for Kim being with us, because it's awkward. But we also have something to do with the washerwoman, apparently. I don't remember.
Our tenant, the policeman. I hope the waves don't keep you up at night. What can I help you with?
Well, they didn't keep him up last night. He slept like a baby. The washerwoman says you'll never find her, you know. She knows the coast like the back of her hand. You only just arrived. Kim says, I wouldn't worry about that, ma'am. We're persistent. Are you sure she didn't go somewhere more pleasant and less wet? Yes, it's going to be too much work for you to find her. She drops the rag into the bucket. It's clean now. Better if you just stay here, get a nice cozy fire going in the heater. Inland Empire says, the felled electric mural. You feel like you should take a... Go look at it again. Step closer this time. Literally have to walk closer? Alright, let's check with Liliana and then we'll go do that. Because actually I don't know what else to do at this point. Other than these two things.
Aye, the sea's gonna calm down soon. I can feel it. The wind is turning southeast. What's on your mind, officer?
Ugh. We're still horrible at this. Try it, I guess. I don't know. Very low. Let's hope for two sixes. Nope. Since the dawn of mankind, Al Ghul has watched over the reproduction of our species. Lay with me. Let's celebrate the ghoul. Now there's a whole shipment of big words. She looks at you from head to toe. May mankind be plentiful, I guess? Can I get back to my nets now? Suggestion says she doesn't even understand you asked her out. Perhaps you're too sober to pull it off right now? Try again later. Well, there might be something to that. Suggestion is a psyche thing. Do I have anything that helps with psyche? No. I don't. Unfortunately, I stink at suggestion. I only have a 2 in it. Alright, let's head to the wall. To the wall. There it is. Step closer, huh? Literally, would that help? Stepping all the way up? Oh, I stepped away again. Very high. Look at that. It says impossible, but very high. For +3 each for found the empty trap and heard Lena's true story. And also death notification. +2 for establish the nightclub and discover the anomaly. Well, that helps too, huh? And +1s for reconstructed execution, confronted the pigs. Very recent, that. And found the jacket. Let us not fail here. Success. Suddenly, there's a sigh carried on the molecules around you, moving, flowing from high pressure to low pressure, like that of a woman emptying her lungs. She wraps the collapsing stone box in front of you in her breath, flowing through it. Where's it go? Into the collapsed roof, flowing down a concrete staircase to the basement, sweeping away footprints in the dust on the stairs, and then the beach below the boardwalk, its winding tunnels a whisper away. What is happening, anyway? She's down there, Shiver says. I guess saying to Kim, I think she's down there, below this building. Okay, why? The wind told me. He shrugs. So how do we get in there? The doors are on the collapsed side of this building. They're gone, basically. Savoir Faire says, finally, my time to shine. There's a ladder next to the sign. Perhaps you can climb them? Enter through the roof? Good task. Perhaps you can climb them. We're not climbing anything. I'm 43 years old, and I plan to live to see 70. Physical instrument says there has to be a way to use brute force. Climbing sounds unsafe. Brute force is safe. Look around and find something to break if the ladder fails. Look around and find something to break. Okay, climb the ladder to the roof or find another way into the Feld building. I'm guessing that's the other way. Is that might be dangerous? Physical instrument? I might hurt myself? Let's try this. Oh, we're gonna go slow. Let's not go slow. An old pipe peeks out from beneath the rotting boards of this boardwalk. Could this be an alternative path into the Feld building? Visual Calculus says, a building like this must have multiple doors serving various functions. Perhaps a basement access? Come closer and look in. Your eyes slowly begin to adjust to the darkness inside the drainage pipe. The lieutenant looks over your shoulder. What's in there? An ordinary drainage pipe. Darkness. Okay, what else? As your eyes adjust, you see some trash. Crumpled up newspapers, cigarette butts. Someone has half-heartedly spray-painted skulls on the right side. And nothing. Broken glass from bottles thrown against the walls of the pipe. A syringe. Could we get into the Feld building through this pipe? Given that this isn't a martial arts thriller, a grin flickers across his face, it's highly unlikely, and not without risk to our health, either. However, the pipe suggests there may be an entrance to the basement around. The lieutenant pushes aside the reeds and looks around. And it's right here, a maintenance door. He points to a rusted metal double door to the right of the pipe, obscured by the reeds. Huh. I wonder if we could have had a chance to find that. Interfacing says it's jammed shut. The subtle approach isn't going to work on this one. Endurance says, oh yeah, big boy time. This needs you to put your back into it. Alright. Try to pull the door apart. Plus one for broken to Kuno's apartment and broken to the communist apartments. Okay, so I guess we're getting used to breaking into things. Let's try it. Success. The metal doors are heavy, and the flaking rust hurts your palms, but together with the lieutenant, you manage to slide them open just enough to squeeze in. Wait, I'm wearing some kind of gloves or something. Good work. The lieutenant nods toward the impenetrable darkness inside. Shall we? Wow, new place. Explore the passages below the Feld building. Indeed, indeed. I guess that will bring us back out. You should take out your flashlight. Thanks. Thanks for that. This overturned table is covered in orange mildew, crawling with something. Okay, so we've got this, which probably goes into dialogues. These are like little line things, and that looks like a way to go in further. Antiquated office furniture. Last century, maybe? Brought down and forgotten so long ago. The collapse nearly sealed the basement. One can barely squeeze by. Maybe there's another way through. Old file folders in the cart. Documents silvery with mold. Oh. I thought it was going to be something more. A series of thick, dusty panes of glass. Interfacing says, this isn't just glass, there are old computation components. These are computer components? Yes, filament memories. From the time when wires were cast in glass, slides with an inlaid nervous system. How'd they do that? And why? The how was a closely guarded secret, something that was locked in safes and human heads across the river to where they were manufactured. As to why, your fingers don't know. But Encyclopedia might. The why is easy, because they hadn't come up with modern silicon-based systems yet. For vitreous cast filament memories, though, these seem incredibly advanced. Hey, Kim, look. Old cybernetics. The lieutenant tilts his head, watching the light glimmer on the glass. So it is. I think these used to form a single system, slotted in the wall. So this is all that remains of failed R&D? He nods. The rest of the building seems to have been picked clean. Could this be part of the old failed playback experiment? These? No, these are old filament memories. I hope you're not expecting to find that device here. You'll be disappointed. Inland Empire says all you will find here is pain. Thanks for that. And then here we have something. An intersolary suit jacket. A muted brown suit jacket, perfect for a day at the office or an evening at a cafe. The red rose at the bottom of the left breast pocket is slowly wilting. Plus one suggestion for dress for the occasion. Could I put this on and then try again for the date? It makes no sense now, I know. I'm not going to run out of here and then go on a date. But I'll keep it in mind. It's bad enough last episode I made no sense by playing that Warrell game when the whole place is going to be nuked by a mercenary group or something. Okay, I guess we came from here. And then we continue up there. Oh wait, there's something here. A postcard from Martinez 98. A faded picture postcard from the end of the last century shows Martinez as was before the revolution. It's the height of summer. Rue de Sainte-Guilaine is teeming with parasol-wielding bourgeoisie, and wild pines flags buttress the walkway. Nothing is written on the back. Mm-hmm. And then here, I cannot go through, I guess. The glass is covered with grime and dust. You can barely see out. So we're going up, right, up into the felled building itself. Be careful, this place could come down around our ears. How long has it been abandoned? Alright, so I'll keep it honest here. I actually ended up a power blip or something like that? Or was just my computer? I hope not. The whole thing, my whole computer just restarted, went down, crashed. So I had to play this part over again. Let you know when you get back to original content back to blind again, unfortunately. My last save was actually from after this, but I have to play it again so you'll see it. We crashed like about 10-15 minutes after we went up these stairs. Actually, I'd say it was definitely closer to, like, 8 to 10 minutes. Stones fall. It's a long way down. The gusts of wind. The height feels dizzying. The central support beam has been destroyed by artillery fire. And that's all that's up here. I had thought at this point that this was the way to go, but no, it's a dead end. I miss finding bottles and stuff, actually. Yeah, so I didn't realize for some reason that the cavern, this place underground, had gone on further. See, for some reason I didn't even see this. In the beam of the flashlight, a crevice in the wall. Stale fabric smell and dust. No one slept here in months, maybe years. Revolutionary propaganda on the bunk bed. Ancient flyers and brochures. These pots and plates are full of dust and spider webs. The same slit window you saw from the outside. Visual calculus says, could this have been the killer's hideout and this narrow window, the point of origin of the shot that killed the mercenary? Hand-eye coordination says, this does look like an embrasure, a slit made for shooting out of. Peeking out. Visual calculus says, outside the window, the day is clear and as mild as can be in early spring. Kim, could the killer have used this as a hideout? It's a great place to hide, certainly, but there hasn't been anyone here in ages. I can't see the whirling in rags. The shot didn't come from here. Indeed, no one could get a clear view. Well, at least we've been thorough. I like thorough. Authority says, the lieutenant's voice betrays a slight disappointment, which he glosses over by reasserting control. So this, I had not realized. I was surprised. Check the boardwalk for bullet traces. I had no idea we'd be checking the boardwalk from underneath the Fell building. I was actually looking around kind of on boardwalks. Oh, this too. We had looked at this next. Krasmazov portrait. A mustachioed and mutton-chopped man, amateurishly depicted, gazes at you with sad eyes. A plaque reads, K. Mazov. There's a spider web in the lower left corner of the portrait. He looks a little like Harry, doesn't he? Brush the dust off the portrait. Years' worth of dust is shaken off. The full head of hair, matched by an ample mustache and sideburns, looks a bit silly. Just saving in case that happens again. Here we have a revolutionary's hat. Plus one to Mazovian socioeconomics, friendly neighborhood communard. An Ushanka with the Mazovian logo, a pair of deer antlers on its silvery right front. You feel your ears feel cuddled and cared for by the state. So that's it in here. Boot prints in the sand. One of the soles appears more worn than the other. There's something in the air, an unnatural buzzing. The tunnel collapsed. You'll have to find another way around. It's getting louder, the buzzing sound. Pain threshold says, there it is again, like a swarm of hornets buzzing under your scalp. A strange tingling you can almost smell. Oh, and by the way, the only really challenge I had to do over was to get in through the pipe. Because my save was, my last save that I could play over again and show you guys was before the pipe. I had to load that game 4 times just to get through. I kept failing. And then I was kind of worried that the result was like already slotted in before you take the check, you know, to prevent people from trying checks over and over again, but no, I got through. Lieutenant, do you feel something? No, what do you mean? A pain, strange tingling. So yeah, I'm choosing all the same choices that I did last time. I don't feel it, but he looks ahead, beyond the arch. We should still be careful. There were footprints back there, and I'm pretty sure they were fresh. Hold on, you really don't feel anything? No, but you're the sensitive one. Redrick says, it's not a quib. The situation is dangerous. I saw them too. Footprints with the right sole worn smooth. Looks like our suspect. If she's in here, we need to plan our next step carefully. What do you mean? He lowers his voice. Once we detain a credible suspect, who knows what the Union and the Wild Pines will do? We'll set in motion events we have no control over. Logic says, you will upset the balance of power in Martinez. The deadlock between the company and the Union will destabilize. Interfacing says, this part of town is a fine clockwork puzzle. Disturb its peace and it will start breaking down uncontrollably. Volition says, keep calm. Go over the whole situation in detail. Yeah, but we can't just not find the killer. We can't just let people kill people, right? We've met the Union leader, but haven't gotten any info from him. Maybe we should talk to him more first. I'm guessing this means Everard? You're right. However corrupt he may be, nothing happens in Martinez without him knowing. We might have to dirty our hands, but... Esprit de Corps says, in this case, we can't afford to be squeaky clean. We found out Everett's plan to take the harbor. Maybe we should tell Joyce about it? I'll leave that to your judgment. You already know what I think about cross-pollinating information like this. It's dangerous, but... Rhetoric says, he just can't be sure. Maybe it will yield something useful. How bad do you think things could get? Well, we're not responsible for what we can't predict, are we? I don't think the entire city will be razed to the ground. The entire city. He smiles in the dark. Logic says, if you can't predict it, there's nothing you could have done. What do you think is waiting for us there? I think I see a cavern. The lieutenant's whisper echoes down a tunnel. Maybe more cellars? I think we've been careful enough. We still have the element of surprise. Savoir Faire says, I wouldn't be so sure. You haven't exactly been sneaking. Or maybe not. He puts his hand to his holster. Either way, once we go deeper, there will be no turning back. Okay, so here... Enter the cavern below the Feld building when you're ready. Note, Union and cryptozoology business might end when you do so. So it's telling us pretty much no uncertain terms that it's a point of no return, at least for some things. Cryptozoology is done. So we're going to head back and talk to Joyce, and then... Lillianne is right there. Maybe we can put on the jacket and ask her out and see if that works. So when this whole thing crashed, I was in the middle of talking to Joyce. I had not talked to Lillianne yet, so then we'll be blind again. A little black swallow circles above you. You hear it chirrup. Luckily, we really aren't far, although it seems far. I know I'm saving a lot because I don't want to do this stuff over and over again. The planks creak beneath your weight. Now that we're here, throw another save.
You're back. Good. What can I help you with? Not an umbrella, I hope. I don't need one myself, you see.
She pats her wet raincoat. She looks at the ripples on the water's surface. Okay, this is funny. This is random. It's just because it's raining. She didn't say this last time. She said, remarked, you've come back. You know, do you need help with something else? And she was drinking from her thermos. This time, we got this. Neither do I. Pat, your similarly wet cloak. Very rugged, she nods in approval. Good choice. Now, I suspect you had questions? Nothing like talking to pass a rainy day, am I right? So that's really interesting, because it's raining. We get some other dialogue with her. So the only thing I could see to go into was I've been dealing with Everard again. She nods with well-contained curiosity. Volition says she's not even asking you anything. It's so easy to just say. Ma'am, this whole thing is a takeover. A takeover? He has told me so in his own words. He's taking it. He'll also use the drug trade to finance the harbor. Taking it? She looks toward the colorful mountain of crates, like toy blocks rising above Martinez. Perception says, green livery changing into red, blot by blot. Okay, so at this point, this is where my computer went down, so we're blind from here on in. Conceptualization says, like a cancer of the blood, metastasizing. Metastasizing, right? Then we're talking about a war. Everett needs to let me into the harbor at once. We need to talk about this. He's ready for a war. They all are. They most certainly are not. Her eyes return to you. Krennel has 1,000 men on their payroll. The next batch will be a platoon of 20 men and a gunship. Kim says, I've seen the Union forces. They're better organized than these mercenaries. They also have the support of the people of Revachol West. It will take more than Krennel to wipe them out. Wild Pines will need to send more and better equipped men. Make no mistake, ma'am. I am sure you have the money. The question is, how many years and how many lives are you willing to sacrifice? What do you suggest I do? Will this affect your decision-making process? Not the RCM's job. Rooker should have the harbor. Cut off the snake's head. It's a bluff. No. Bring in everything you have and wipe them from the face of the earth. It's apocalypse o'clock. I wish there was a disco option. Okay, first, will this affect your decision-making process? Everything affects the decision-making process, Detective. Officer, the look on Kim's face conveys uncertainty. He doesn't even sound angry. I'm just saving my recording, just in case. Esprit de Corps says, for once, I don't seem to know what the right thing to do is. Cut off the snake's head. Everett's pushing all this. Like the previous leader of the Union were assassinated? I suspect by Everett and Edgar themselves, she considers it. I admit there's some poetry in the idea, and like poetry, it's also useless. There would still be Edgar. They factored it in. The Union is them, and they are Martinez. So, what are you going to do? What will I do? She says slowly, looking around. Composure says, her arms fall to her sides, her spine relaxes. The wind blows, waves crash in the distance. She crosses her arms and asks, did I ever tell you how they discovered this, Isola, during our reality lowdown? Did she say? I'm not sure. I don't remember. No, ma'am. It may be the only break we've ever caught as a species, the last one for 400 years. Why? The nations who colonized this Isola called theirs Mundi, the world. It was all they knew, all they thought would be. That there would be something more was a gamble, akin to another world, or life after death. The Pale was thought to be impregnable, perpetual. She points northwest. Irene la Navigateur, the Queen of Serene, Serezny sent 8 expeditions, one after the other, into the mass at the edge of the world. 5 of the crews did not return. 2 did, but had lost their minds. And the pale. I wonder if Kim's going to say anything. He did not want her telling us about the pale. Redrick says, each of these expeditions would have been led by an admiral. Sounds like a purge. She was purging her political rivals. Can I put this gun away? I can't get into items, no. Sounds cruel. She nods. There was no precedent for such an undertaking. People thought she was punishing the admirals, or had gone mad, or both. Until after years of trial and error, and the development of a strict psychological regime, imitating the creation process of poetry. Conceptualization says, called Volta do Mar, or Return from the Sea. The 8th expedition returned, sane and intact. They told of a new continent of matter. They told the Queen and her counselor, Dolores Day, that the Pale had begun to condense, day after day, hour after hour, minute after minute, slowly raining down till it formed a vast ocean. Perception smell says, the air is cold and scented with petrichor? I don't know what it is. Petrichor is. This ocean? She nods. The phenomenon has never again been encountered. For a time, the crew thought they were experiencing a hallucination. The masked hand proclaimed, Linsulind? Linsulind? The signal to wake up. But they could not. They were sane and conscious as islands began to appear on the horizon. There are 78,000 uninhabited islands in the Insulindian archipelago, officer. The freckled face of God. She smiles. Conceptualization says, you've thought it a million times. Have I thought this? After life, death. After death, life again. Okay, I guess. After life, death. After death, life again. After the world, the pale. After the pale, the world again. A total shift, she nods. In human comprehension of reality, on the second day, a great squaw was shot down above the flagship Lysergic. The bird was preserved and brought back, along with pollen. I got a thought for the Insulindian miracle. 4 years later, the Queen's counselor was proclaimed her Innocence Dolores Day, the elected world spirit. The age of humanism, internationalism, and parliamentary rule followed. We were high. The great squaw was the first bird they saw? The first living autonomous organism. Proof of reality. It's the symbol of Insulin, Detective. The coat of arms of the suzerain and the wings on the crest of the commune. Oh, like that, hat I just found. I seem to have it in for it, or it for me. I broke one. In your defense, it is a nasty creature who plucks food from the throats of lesser birds. Yet, much like Revachol, it is also magnificent. And rare. Imagine the suzerain of seagulls. And this was the last break we got? The nations of Mundi proceeded to discover 5 more isolae, or they discovered us, all in the rush of the great intersolary reconnection. But these others weren't inhabited. We had to kill people there, wipe out indigenous populations, gunboat economics, or they came to do the same for us, or had done to each other. But here, she spreads her arms, there was no one but the squaw, the Lilacia, and the blood beach and the river Esperance. It was the new world. The Mondials used it to amass the greatest concentration of wealth mankind has ever seen, Revachol, the suzerain. What happened? Looking around. Revolution, poverty, and the mercurial rise of capitalism. Leaving us here? On Kailu. She studies your reaction. The pebble, the largest of the fertile, uninhabited islands of the northeast Insulindian archipelago. 4 centuries and 2 revolutions later. Why would I say it's raining? What will you do? I will take your advice, Lieutenant Euphrador. I will surrender Terminal B to the Union. Surrender it? Is that within your means? She pats her hand in the rain. She's silent for a second. Well, she puts her hand on in. She puts her hand in the rain. She's silent for a second. We will see. Ma'am, Kim says, this may well unravel property law this side of the river. If that occurs, we may never see the end of this kind of confrontation. The next time there will be 2 strikes. He looks toward the harbor. Then 4, then 100. What happens will happen. She takes the end in her rain-slick hand and starts untying the knot. The age of capital has only begun. I will talk to my employers in person. We will amputate and cauterize Martinez if you handle the situation on the ground. You're going now? Yes. Mr. Clare has a 2-month head start. I can't let it grow any bigger, and I've exhausted all my options from here. Rhetoric. Very high. We? She generally avoids that term with her employers. There are no employers, Rhetoric says. She's a member of the board, probably a partner. You are the Wild Pines. There are no employers. She turns to you, rope in hand. You are the citizens' militia. There are no superiors. What? Of course I have superiors. Kim says, that's right, detective. And next time you should confer with them before you go setting events in motion. Empathy says, despite his words, he's not really sure whether to be annoyed with you or not. He said it was up to us. I know he wasn't fond of it, but he said it was up to us. Logic says, events are already in motion. Whether your actions accelerated or momentarily retarded their progress, even a lieutenant cannot really say. Even after all this time, I still don't really understand who you are or what your angle is. I have not deceived you. I told you exactly who I was. Rejoice, Layton. Understood.
Keep the peace, and I will keep my end of the bargain.
How far along is Prunell's investigation?
A confrontation is imminent. They have followed in your footsteps. As your investigation reaches a climax, so does theirs. They are your shadow. Arm yourselves. Armor yourselves. Protect their targets. Violence may be unavoidable, but we can limit the casualties.
When will they make their move? Where?
Soon. I do not know precisely. They have cut off all communication, you see. They know I've been feeding you information. One last thing, Lieutenant Dubois. I've given the matter much thought and come to this conclusion. You're not an amnesiac. You're insane. I know, because I too am insane. I just hide my illness better. And I'm rich.
Nether creature of the Forbidden Swamp. Well, this one doesn't conclude, but why would I say that to her? Isn't everybody a little insane?
No, detective. No one's as insane as you.
Is she serious?
Don't worry, madame. I am very sane.
Are you over-radiated?
I'm overexposed, baby. My travels take me through the pale dozens of times a year. I've got the longing, and I've got it bad.
She points to her heart. Empathy says she would die to return to it. The pale, the past, anything one can return to. How do you keep it together?
The same strict psychological regimen the 8th Admiral developed when he crossed the pale and discovered this isola, the Volta de Mar. It's used by inter-isolary travelers and other troubled souls even to this day.
Okay, so 2 words I've been saying wrong. I've been saying isola, it's isola. And... is that what she said? An inter-isolary travelers. I'll try to remember that. Volition says, you could use a little of it yourself. Goodbye, Rejoice Layton.
Watch out for yourselves. They will strike soon.
New skill point. And that, just like that, she's gone. The lieutenant watches her boat grow smaller on the bay, its white sails fluttering. Esprit de Corps says, with worry in his eyes, he does not know if it was the right thing to do, but doesn't say anything. Logic says, you wonder what Everard has to say about this. perception sight says slowly the sails turn a gray-blue as more oxygen gets between you. Oh, wow. Okay. So I got another skill point. And we got a thought for the Insulinian Miracle, which takes 7 hours and 45 minutes. You were reminded of a poem somewhere deep inside you, the translation of which you don't remember. Nulla sarà cambiato della luce. It begins, colori cum grigio e marron, tutti stampati uno solatro, trovai un vuoto, una macchia bianca, gli altri guardano, che bella giornata, che bel tempo, ma senti la retrotiva. Hope I said at least some of that right. You were reminded of it when you heard about the discovery of insulin, but what does it mean, and how do you know it by heart? What beautiful something, and beautiful tempo? One white something. Yeah, that's all I know.
Yes?
I found out what the pale is while you were gone. Wonderful. He does not even seem surprised. What is your takeaway? Wait, you're not surprised? I can't stop a grown man from learning about the fundamental geographic and entroponetic features of our world, can I? Esprit de Corps says, perhaps I shouldn't have tried, he thinks. He's trying to protect us. Rhetoric says, perhaps I was overprotective, is what's insinuated. Insinuating. I think it's terrifying. And I was right to spare you from it, no? He cracks a little smile. Anyway, the pale is no more terrifying than, say, water, or death, or that we're stuck behind our eyes for all eternity. Really? He looks around, pensive suddenly. Excuse me, large topics are not my forte. You seem stable enough. Keep it that way. Now, was there anything else, or should we get to it? Wow. Been talking for a while. Let's try to ask her out. If not, if it doesn't work, I can put another point, I suppose, into suggestion and try again. Almost 11 a.m., and I guess at that point, I had to see if we could warn Titus. Maybe we should even warn, what's her name? Blondie, Classier. Not sure who else. And then talk to Everard, I guess. I'm not going to get into drug trade with him, sorry. We're not getting my hands dirty that way. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.